So Lizzie, first of all, thank you so much for coming up and joining us at the club. I think I was very much motivated as a youngster off the back of some of the things you did, and that led me to end up with these crazy people in the 19 career. So everyone's got their own story, so it'd be wonderful to hear yours tonight.
Great.
And a big thanks to Lionel. I said I'd buy him dinner if you came along tonight, so I owe him a meal. So thanks very much for making that happen. So, ladies and gentlemen.
Obviously, one of these
Well, I haven't prepared much of a talk other than to talk about amateur radio and adventure, really, because it's interesting. I've done 5 flights around the world and a couple of balloon flights, and amateur radio's had a tremendous effect on the early flights. These days, of course, with GPS and a Iridium telephone, everything's changed. And I'm so glad that I did my first 2 flights around the world before GPS. The last 2 flights I've done have been with GPS and Iridium, and it really takes the excitement out of it because you know exactly where you are and you know exactly how much field range you've got. But let me tell you a bit about my first flight around the world. First of all, a little bit about my background. Many of you would know it. I was hopeless at school, went to Rosie Public School, was in East Roseville Rover crew, used to come up here walking on my first class walks around Terry Hills and out to Roach Creek and places like that. I was good at 2 things. One was I loved the out-of-doors, the scouts, and the other one I loved radio, which we called it in those days. My dad would go into Price's Radio and Angel Place and buy components, and I built a crystal set when I was 8. I was never any good theoretically, so I suppose people would say I was dyslectic. I had a speech defect until I was 8 years of age, so I used to say my name was Dick Miff. And everyone laughed like you do. Well, to all those people who laughed, my nice Citation aircraft, which I'm flying up to Hamilton Island on Friday, its call sign is Mike India Foxtrot Miff, so anyway, I left school and went and worked for Weston Electronics. My first job was winding coils for the LM18 HF transceiver. Westerns were in Sydenham and they made 2-way radios, VHF, AM, valve radios, and also HF radios for the Royal Flying Doctor Service and bushfire use. And in those days, I was trying to do the electronics communication certificate course. Anyone did that? Go on. Oh, look, good on you. You're geniuses. I lasted a few lectures and realised I wasn't going to be able to get through that, but which I would have loved to. I have no qualifications. My only qualification is my amateur radio licence, and I'll tell you soon how I got that. I'd love to have a qualification, but I just didn't have the abilities to be able to do that. I always worked really hard, but really hard at understanding things. Except when I was at school, when I was 14, I built a noughts and crosses computer. I'd been to the Powerhouse Museum and seen a noughts and crosses computer that was made with valves and inductors and everything. And so I built one out of telephone parts, uni-selectors and locking relays, and you could play noughts and crosses against it and you could never win. You'd either tie or it would win. And so I was quite good practically. And when I worked at Westerns, I used to go out and do installations, and I could do them very quickly. And one day, there was a great kerfuffle at the Western factory, and I said, what's going on? They said, oh, that radio that's just been brought in, it's made by this terrible bloke called Maurie Finlay. Anyone ever heard of Maurie Finlay?
Yeah. I worked with him 10 years ago.
Oh, well, there you are. Terrible bloke, Maurie Finlay. And I said, who's Maurie Finlay? Oh, he was one of the engineers here, but they had to sack him because he stole from us. I then learned that anyone who left Western Electronics, they always said they sacked them. And they always said they stole from them. Of course, Maurie Finlay didn't get sacked and didn't steal. He opened his own business in Eastern Valley Ray, just down there where the old tanneries were, in the Gilco building, which is now the Christian Church building. And I was riding my little motor scooter from where I lived in Coongara Road, Roseville Chase, to Sydenham every day. And I thought, wow, someone making 2-way radios just down the road from me because I lived in Coongara Road. And so I raced out to the telephone box, no cell phones in those days, and somehow got through to Finlay Communications and spoke to this Maury Finlay. And he said, can you do installations? And I said, can I ever?
What year are we talking, Dick?
This is, I can give you the exact year, it was 1962, okay. June of 1962. I did the living, I managed to get the living certificate, and then I left school in 61. And in 62, started with Westerns in January, and then in June, I saw the two-way radio, that Maury Finlay two-way radio. And so I went and worked for Maury Finlay, and used to do installations, which I was good at, and just wiring radios and everything. And I then, through the East Rosal Scouts, I'd met... Oh, no, it was quite an interesting story here, because he's the clue to starting Dick Smith Electronics. When I was working for Maury Finlay, I just to try and get my ham radio license, and I'd managed to get my limited call sign, because I had great difficulty learning Morse code, and I got VK2ZIP. And Maury Finlay said to me, oh, one of the investors in this company is a radio ham. His name is Dr. Tony Balthazar. And so I managed to get his phone and I rang him up. He was a very wealthy bachelor who lived at Point Piper. And I went over and saw him, and at first, he's very strange, he used to wear a monocle and speak French half the time. And I became very friendly with him, and I was the first person. He was an only child, and his parents had just died, and that mollycoddled him the whole life. He was in the scouts, but he wasn't allowed to go on the scout camp. He had some girlfriends, but his mother never approved. And so finally, he must have been about 45 years of age, and his mum and dad, his dad was a Belgian consul, his mum was a homemaker, but they were wealthy. He lived in this beautiful unit at Buckhurst, and he had Swan amateur radio gear. And if you had Swan, you were wealthy, you know, wow. And so I would go around there, and then I talked him into coming to our scout hall at East Rosal, just on Rosal Bridge. And then 50 years ago, in 2 weeks' time, I convinced him to provide the money for us scouts to sail out to Ball's Pyramid. And I said, look, it'd be great if you provide the money, we can use ham radio. So we put the Swan transceiver on a 50-foot ketch, and we all sailed out to Lord Howe. You wouldn't be allowed to do it now. Attempted to climb Ball's Pyramid, failed, but used amateur radio. And when I was out there, Tony Balthazar, we were walking up Intermediate Hill, and he said, Dick, you've changed my life. He said, this was in 1964, so I would have been 20 years of age. And at the time, I was working for Maury Finlay. He said, you've changed my life. I want to pay you to go to university. And in those days, you had to get a scholarship, or you'd have to pay, sort of thing. And I said, well, look, I'd be hopeless at that, but would you ever loan me the money to start a business? And he said, well, yes, I would. Anyway, the next year, he bought me a ticket to go around the world. And the reason he did that is he wanted to do the scout climbing course in Candlestick and wasn't going to do it himself. And he knew that I would do it with him. So we did that. Came back from overseas. Amazingly enough, Maury Finlay had moved to Gore Hill, but Western Electronics had moved into the Boots building next door to Gilco at Eastern Valley Way. And I always wanted to work close to home. So I got back from this world trip and I rang up Westerns, and I thought, I'll never get anywhere as a technician. I was a bloody good two-way radio technician. I can fix radios. So that was one thing I was good at. I thought I was a complete failure. All my friends had gone off to university. I tried to get into DCA when I was 15 and the PMG, all of those things, and I couldn't get into any of them. It was amazing. Especially when I became chairman of CAA years later. So here I am. I've come back and I thought, I'll never get anywhere as a two-way radio technician because I don't have any qualifications. Maybe I could be a salesman. So I went down to Westerns and I said, I'd like to apply for a job as a two-way radio salesman. And they said, no, you know nothing about two-way radio sales and we want you as a technician. And in those days, you were never without a job. And so I applied for a couple of jobs. I was thinking of joining the National Parks, and luckily for me, it was the year that National Parks rangers had to have a degree for some bloody reason. So I didn't get into that. And I was just about to ring Westerns and say, I'll take the job as a technician fixing two-way radios, because they had the contract for Manly cabs, which were AM in those days, old valve equipment. And Westerns rang me up and said, oh, we'll give you a go as a salesman. And for the first, I was called a sales engineer. Can you imagine that? I've still got the card. Dick Smith, sales engineer, woo! Yeah. I wasn't an engineer, but it sounded good. And I for the first 6 months, I couldn't sell anything. I was bloody hopeless. But after a while, I started to work out how to be a good salesman. And in the end, after about 18 months, I started selling enormous amounts of two-way radios. But I was quite disillusioned because we were selling AM radios, valve equipment, and STC had come up with their beautiful 151 series solid-state unit. And I tried to talk Westerns into making a solid-state unit, an FM, which was better. And I remember I was so disillusioned, I went down to GKN Building and Engineering, and they had 50 pie leaders, and they were looking at a quote from Western Electronics and from STC, and the obvious thing for them to buy would be STC equipment. It was so superior. FM, solid state, 25 watt, and I had this little crappy little 5 watt Western Electronics LM230 or something like that. But I got the sale, and they bought 50 of these radios, and I was the hero, but I thought, oh, I don't really like this. And I remember saying to Alan Walker, who ran Westerns, and he ended up coming work for me at Dick Smith's, I said, look, I don't really like this. And he said, oh, if you're a good salesman, you have to be loyal to your company. And suddenly Weston said, we're no longer going to fix the radios for Manly Cabs. And I sort of saw my opportunity. Now, they'd made a terrible mistake. When I was going around as a salesman, Vinton, right? Ever anyone remember Vinton?
Yeah.
Well, the Vinton salesman said, oh, we want to get you as a salesman, we've heard you've been selling a lot, and we'll provide a car. Now, up until then, I'd been 18 months come back from overseas, 1966, 67. I could never save any money because, as you know, in those days, you get 30 quid a week or $30 or something, $60, and you spend it all on your car. And I had a car on hire purchase and all the rest of it. And so Vinton offered me the job with the car, so I said to Westerners, I had no intention of taking the job. I've been offered a job by Vinton, they're going to give me a car. And very quickly, Weston said, we'll give you a car. So they gave me a car. It was the greatest mistake they could have ever made because for the first time in my life, I saved some money. And after about 4 or 5 months, I had $600. I always remember this, and my fiance at the time, Pippi McManamy from Bayview Girl Guides or whatever it was, she was 17. She only had $10. I always mention this because we started Dick Smith Electronics with $610, $600 for me, $10 for her. And if ever we get divorced, that's how it's divided up. Anyway, she puts in her $10 because she's still at school, and I put in my $600 because Westerns had stupidly given me this car and I saved some money. And I said to Westerns, I'm going to leave and start a business fixing the Manly Cab two-way radios. And I did. I started the business down, well, initially at the Big Bear at Neutral Bay underneath the car park, $15 a week rent, and started fixing two-way radios. And I got the agency for STC 151 two-way radios. And I sold a lot of two-way radios because I really believed in them and they were the best and state-of-the-art thing. Sold a lot to ABC cabs and sold them to business people and people like that. Now, where the story gets exciting, I then moved from about after 7 months at the Big Bear, I moved up to Gore Hill. And I was servicing two-way radios, selling car radios, and one day I went into the city to George Brown's. Anyone remember George Brown? Put up your hand.
Yes, yes.
Now, George Brown was a typical wholesaler, electronic parts wholesaler. You'd have up to a dozen people behind the counter. The service was so bad you'd have fist fights because, you know, who was going to be served next? And I remember thinking, wow, if these people are so hopeless and they've got so many customers there, I should get into selling electronic components. And so I rented a little house for about $20 a week at number 10 Atchison Street, just down from the Wireless Institute of Australia. And I started Dick Smith Wholesale, selling electronic components. Stupidly, I put on a manager and his offsider who I knew very little about and put 15 grand into it, bought all this stock. And about 4 months or 5 months after we started doing a bit of business. It was always the conventional way, everything on account, and you'd come in one resistor, 8 cents, plus 27.5% sales tax, you'd calculate and write out this bloody great docket. And suddenly my manager said, I'm leaving. And the offsider said, I'm resigning too. And I thought that was ridiculous. And why are you leaving? Oh, they wouldn't tell me. And so I had to go down and run the business myself. And about 2 weeks later, at about 11 o'clock at night, I suddenly realised that the manager had stolen 15 grand's worth of stock. No, 18 grand's worth. What he had done is he knew that George Brown and various companies like that would not send the invoices until the end of the month. And so he bought all his stock. I was so dumb, and it was only when I found an envelope with invoices and I thought it had some very expensive silicon control rectifiers, and I went to the bin and there weren't any there. And then I started going through all the boxes and I realised I'd been conned. I rang up the police and the name, Bill Mostyn, oh, we know him, great. They've never had a conviction against him, but he had form. They immediately got a search warrant for his house and raced down his house. He's got boxes of electronic components, but he had receipts from the Jeff K. Gray auction house for electronic components, and there was no way of proving where the box came from. Now, that terrible thing was the best thing that could have ever happened to me, because with the $18,000 lost, considering I only put 15 grand in the business, it was in a terrible strait. It was going to go broke. And my accountant said, oh, you should liquidate the business. And I was so dumb, to this day I can't read a balance sheet, but I said, what does liquidate mean? He says, oh, well, you just close it down, sell all the stock off. And I said, well, what's going to happen to the money that's lost? And he said, well, that's bad luck. It's a proprietary limited company. The people who gave you credit, they'll lose their money. And I remember thinking, because of my background in the Scouts and I suppose my parents, I said, well, but how will I live with myself? You know, Dick Smith wholesale going broke. And my accountant said, well, that's just life. You've had the stock stolen. It's well known. You've been to the police and there's nothing they can do about it. And then he saw my concern and he said, well, one thing you could do is you could appoint a receiver. And he said, that's a firm of accountants who can run the company with you and pay back the debt. And I said, well, that's what I'll do. I'll pay back the debts. I reckon I could do it in about 2.5-3 years and I'll close the bloody business down. I said, that was a really sensible lesson. Don't start up something that you know nothing about. And I'll stick to the car radios and two-way radios that lie under dashboards, fixing radios and everything. Now, I'm not a religious person, but if there is a God there, I believe in karma, do the right thing and the right thing happens to you. When I'm down there behind the counter, there was a company called Kitsets that had just started, and Kitsets were selling electronic components, including tax. They didn't have all this tax crap and all the rest of it, and they were doing really well by mail order. And I looked at this crazy way of doing things, and I thought, gee, if we just paid the tax, I remember I got in touch with the tax department. They said, well, to pay the tax on all your goods, it was about $10,000. I went to custom credit. I've virtually never borrowed any money in my life, except for Tony Butler's. I loaned me about $3,000 to start the car radio and two-way radio business. But I borrowed the money from custom credit, paid all the tax, and then started selling, in effect, retail, which is what every business is now. And I also bought out a little catalogue called the First Dick Smith Catalogue, which I had a coupon in Electronics Australia magazine. And I remember I went down to get the catalogue printed. I took the photos myself with a box branded camera, typed up the text. I got it printed very cheaply, and they cost 12 cents a copy or something, and we were selling them for 50 cents in an ad in EA. And the bloke who was the printer, he just burst out laughing. He said, you'll never sell catalogue. You'll be lucky to give them away. So I changed the order from 10,000 to 5,000 or 3,000 or something, put the coupon in. To cut a long story short, within about 12 months, we were making more money out of catalogues than selling electronic components. And the business just started to boom. And down there in that little Atchison Street, I then realised I'd closed the car radio business. We moved Dick Smith Wholesale up into the flats next door to the car radio business. And then one day I said to my staff, forget this car radio business. I'm going to wind down the shutter. I'm going to put Huger carpet tiles in a lowered ceiling and Muzak. Remember Muzak? Oh, yeah. And I took a cheap ticket around the world and found that there was Lafayette and Radio Shack and Heathkit, places like that were selling components a different way. And so we put it all out in bins and the type of a J car now that you look at. I did that, and I remember saying, the first year I'm going to turn $1 million over in this shop. And it was exciting because I'd come in on a Saturday morning, there would be 50 people lined up outside the Gore Hill shop. Just absolutely amazing. And I started, and then the most fortuitous thing happened. Gough Whitlam came in, and most of what we sold was locally made, which was fantastic. I made selected calling equipment and power supplies. I was a manufacturer myself. One day it suddenly announced Gough Whitlam's taken all the duty off everything. And I'm often blamed, you know, people say, how can you be helping Australian farmers? You know, wrecked the Australian electronics industry. Wasn't quite that. I was part of the Aussie electronics industry when Whitlam took the duty off, and very quickly all of these companies closed. AWA, Ducon, Plessy, all the manufacturers closed. And so I started buying from importers, but very quickly I couldn't get enough stock. So I went overseas to Japan, and it just opened up my eyes. Then I think the yen to the dollar now is about 75 yen to an Aussie dollar. Then it was 425 yen to the Aussie dollar. So we could buy stuff in just so cheaply. Our first container load came in, and as you know, Dick Smith Electronics went from a tiny business to 50 stores around Australia, turning over $50 million a year and doing incredibly well. But when I got to about 500 staff, most people think if you're wealthy, your plan was always to be wealthy. Well, I never had that plan. I didn't like wealthy people. I thought if ever I become wealthy, I'll share it with all my staff. The interesting thing was, in the early days, I had all these bonus systems, but some people are not motivated by bonuses, and when we had a bad month, my staff would be resigning, and I'd say, why are you resigning? Oh, I'm not getting my bonus. And I'd say, yeah, that's because our turnover's way down. Oh, well, you can afford to pay it. And it was, I really learnt that there are people who are motivated by incentive, and there are people who would like a nice, steady job with a guaranteed income. So I learnt lots of those things on the way. And you probably remember we moved from the Gore Hill, we moved to enormous, Carlisle Street, into enormous special built warehouse at North Ryde. And the business, I think, when I sold it to Woolworths in 1982, it was turning over 32 million and the net profit was 8 million. So we were making 25 cents net in the dollar. Mm. Woolworths today make about 2.5 cents in the dollar. But it was because it was completely vertically integrated. We would buy directly from Japan and we would retail, and we didn't sell anything you can compare a price with. We had the Dick Smith System 80 computer. People said, why don't you sell Apple? Why don't you sell IBM? Prices weren't, the margins weren't good enough, and I wanted to run a business that would last, that I could pay the staff and that could do well. And when I got to that 50 million turnover, I said, oh, I'm going to sell out, I'm going to go venturing and spend more time with my family. It was amazing. I was treated as an eccentric because at the time my accountant said, you could become a Rupert Murdoch. Rupert had just moved to England, and I realised the formula that we had could be repeated right around the world with the catalogues and all the rest of it. But I didn't want to do that. I thought, gee, as you probably know, I sold out to Woolworths for over $20 million and I was 36 years of age. And I wanted to then do other things. And I went on and flew around the world and then started Australian Geographic. And now I have Dick Smith Foods, which is sort of a charitable thing. But I want to get onto my adventure. So what I wanted to do is to go adventuring. And I'd learned to fly when I was running Dick Smith Electronics. He's a nice, friendly master. And I wanted to...
Everyone's come to your lecture tonight.
He's looking for some Dick Smith peanut butter. Is this boring? Am I going on? Anyway, so where am I? I've sold the business and I decided to go adventuring. And I'd learned to fly right at the time, just after Dick Smith Wholesale went into receivership. I was really worried and I was working 7 days a week, but I found out you could go out to Hoxton Airport at about 6 a.m. in the morning and for $22 an hour you could learn to fly. So I learned to fly a little Cherokee and I hated it because you bloody thing, there's always wings. There were low wing planes I learned to fly in, and so you could never see much anyway. And if you could see something, there was never an airstrip nearby. You could never land. So I didn't really like it that much. But I then bought a little twin Comanche plane. And then one day I thought I could never get an instrument rating because of my dyslexia and difficulty in learning things. I looked at the study papers for the instrument rating, which are just double Dutch even today, and I do have an instrument rating now, I don't know how I got it, but I looked at the papers and I thought, I'll never get an instrument rating, so I had to fly visually everywhere. And one day I was flying back from Tasmania with my wife and kids, the kids probably then were 6 and 7 or something, and I got stranded at Narandra Airport in really bad weather. The weather's really bad, and I have to ring up Bankstown to get a pilot to fly a plane up with another pilot to fly my plane back with my family, because I couldn't fly in the bloody cloud. And as I'm waiting there, I hear thump, 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 and a helicopter comes in and lands. And it was a chap called Chick Barrett in the Electricity Commission Jet Ranger. And I walked over to him and I said, wow, is this an instrument-rated helicopter? And he looked at me and said, no! He said, with a helicopter, you just fly under the cloud. And he said, if the cloud gets too low, you land and have a cup of tea with somebody. If you knew me, that's me. That's my type of flying. So, finally got flown back the next day to Sydney, and we were running Dick Smith, the head office from Carlotta Street, and I rang up Bell Helicopters, and business was making about $1 million a year profit, and the helicopter was 200 grand. I said, I want to buy a helicopter, and ordered one, and then went up with an instructor and picked it up from the Brisbane Bell place, flew it down to my farm at Ross Glen, and in 3 weeks learned to fly the damn thing. And my life just changed. I mean, a helicopter is the most amazing thing. It is the ultimate off-road vehicle. It is the magic carpet. And I'd always thought, because I had fixed-wing aircraft, the tradition was you bought a fixed-wing aircraft in America and you flew it back across the Pacific Ocean, put in big tanks like King's Smith, and that was a dream of mine. When I got into helicopters, that was not possible, but I'd worked out maybe if you put a big tank in it, you could fly it home to Australia via the UK, across the northern Atlantic, and then down through Europe to Australia. And then someone said, oh, if you're going to fly that far, why don't you fly around the world? And I said, well, you can't fly around the world because you can't get across the Pacific Ocean. The distances are too great. And in those days, it was the time of the Cold War. All the original solo flights and fixed-wing flights by Wiley Post around the world had just gone through Russia, and the crossing of the Pacific is 60 miles on the Bering Strait up north. But then I looked at it and thought, well, surely the Russians would give me approval. And so I had this plan, and I thought, if I don't get approval from the Russians, I'll try and put some fuel on a ship and land on the ship. But I thought, I'll never have to do that because I'll get approval from the Russians. Anyway, I realised that for the helicopter flight around the world, I really needed amateur radio. But I couldn't do the Morse code. And I tried and tried and tried. And in the end, a chap called Bill Storer. Anyone remember Bill Storer?
French's Forest.
Yeah. French's Forest. He's still alive today. Bill, for some reason, he felt sorry for me. So he came to my house and he tested my Morse code. Because you were supposed to do 13 words a minute or something? 14 words a minute. Well, I went da-da-da-da. And he, not corruptly, but realised it was better that I be alive, because you couldn't have an HF ham radio. It's different now, isn't it? You can have HF. In those days, you have to have Morse code. No one used Morse code, but not many people.
Well, anyway. Some of us used.
Yeah. Can you imagine me flying my helicopter? Da 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 da. Anyway, he very kindly, I don't know how it worked out, but you're supposed to go in to get your Morse code done, and it's getting closer and closer to my departure. I don't have my full call sign, and I really need it to be safe on this trip. And no satellite phones in those days. And he said, I'll come around to your house and I'll test you. And I said, oh, I'm not very good. Anyway, da da da, and he gave me my license, which was just, and you wouldn't believe it, about 30 years after that flight around the world, we had a talk in at the Paris Museum, and I invited him along, and I was able to thank him for giving me that license. And so the trip around the world in the helicopter, and this is getting about what my talk's about, it was a frightening thing, because first of all, I was solo and I was very inexperienced. I'd only done 700 hours in a helicopter, and I'd visualised that I would always fly in good weather. But one of the first mistakes I made was to organise with Malcolm Fraser. I said, look, I've heard Prince Charles is a helicopter pilot. I said, if I can get my helicopter to England, I was going to take off from the Bell factory at Fort Worth, it'll be the first solo crossing of the Atlantic by rotary wing aircraft. I said the first solo by fixed wing aircraft was Lindbergh. I said this will be a first rotary wing, and it'll be by an Australian. Normally the Americans hold just about every absolute record held by the Americans. And so Malcolm Fraser wrote off to Prince Charles, and he came back, yeah, fantastic, I'll be on my summer holidays in Balmoral Castle, tell Mr. Smith to call in. So we worked out this date, the 12th of August or something, I planned up. Now that was an enormous mistake, because I planned to fly the Atlantic in the middle of a high pressure system. Beautiful weather. I got into a low pressure system, the most outrageous weather I couldn't believe you could fly in. And imagine if you're with me, the helicopter's tiny, it's the size of a tiny mini miner. The whole back of it is fuel, 200 gallons of fuel instead of 90 gallons. I've got a little life raft sitting beside me, a life jacket on, no floats on the helicopter because if you put floats on, you don't get the range. And one engine, but it is a very reliable engine. And I had a survival suit on, no GPS. So once you left the continent to fly over the water, you didn't have a clue what ground speed you were doing. That was a problem. And I remember the day I took off from Greenland to get to Iceland, and it's 430 nautical miles, about 5 hours of flying. I got about halfway across and I got into weather so bad, I'm winding in and out through snow storms and snow flurries. Down below me is a 50 to 80 knot gale on the ocean, and it's blowing bits of icebergs off the top of each other. And I'm sitting there thinking, I told everyone, I've had an engine failure, I just auto-rotate, a helicopter glides, and then I'll roll the helicopter and lift and climb out into my life raft. I looked, I thought it was freezing, the water was on. I was going to live about 1 second. And I had a little Super 8 camera to talk to, because ingrained in me from a kid was, you must always have a work ethic. And so even though I could have afforded to fly around the world, I decided I would make a documentary film, take still photos for a book, and make the thing a working holiday, which it was in the end. And I had pre-sold the films to Channel 10 in Sydney. And it's interesting, when I played the film back, my editor said, oh, it's a problem, there's a fault. When you're about halfway across the Atlantic, there's a fault with the audio. Have a listen. And in fact, the audio, there was a tremor in my voice. I was so scared. And I was talking to the camera to try and get some confidence, but I was so scared. I thought, I'll never get through to Reykjavik in Iceland. The needle, I'm trying to track in on a radio station there, but because there were so much storms around, the needle's sort of wavering like this. So I decided I think I should go back. I was just at my point of return. I would better go back to Greenland. So I called up a high-flying airline. Now, I did have the amateur radio, and from Iceland on, I spoke to the Yaesu agents in Matlock. I'll think of their name in a minute. The Yaesu agents in Matlock, Lowe's. But for some reason, I couldn't get HF contact there. So I didn't have any contact other than using my VHF. I went on to the guard frequency, the emergency frequency 1215, and I said, anyone copy? An airline popped up, who was obviously way up flying the Atlantic. And I said, I'm trying to get into Iceland, but the weather's too bad here. I'm going to go back to Greenland. Can you check the weather in Greenland? And so they radioed someone. And they came back, they said, no, the weather's closed in Greenland. You won't be able to get back there. We recommend you go to Shanwick. Now, Shanwick is in Ireland. And that's about 2,000 miles away. I called up, and I'm trying to explain to you, I'm in a helicopter, and he just doesn't believe me. You're in a helicopter, and they're looking down at this weather. And they said, we think if you keep persevering towards Iceland, it'll get a bit better. So I'm winding in and out, and I don't know how much fuel I've got because I've got a headwind. And I am so frightened. I think, if I get out of this alive, I'll have to come up with some excuse, because I'd had quite a lot of publicity of leaving, and Dick Smith's going to attempt to fly around the world. And so I was thinking of this incredible excuse. I would land at Iceland if I was alive and say, oh, I'm going to ship the helicopter back. There's a problem mechanically or something. But the amazing thing was, as I got towards Reykjavik, about the last 50 miles, the weather started to lift. And as I actually got to the airport, there was a ray of sunlight through an opening in the cloud, straight onto the air terminal. Just amazing. So I tracked up and I landed there and I climbed out. And I remember I was just absolutely scared, and I walked inside and I got into the coffee shop and I sat there. Now, the amazing thing about the human condition, and you, when you hear of great feats of endurance and people who go to war and that, is that the human body is designed to have fear, but it's also designed very quickly to forget that fear. And so I'm sitting there having a cup of coffee, and I thought, oh, it really wasn't that bad after all. Maybe I'll just go on to Scotland for Prince Charles. And in fact, the whole flight around the world was like that, because some of the really terrifying times were really bad. So that day I managed to get to a place called Hornafjorda, and then I crossed the Northern Atlantic into Scotland. I then got really good communication to Lowe's, the amateur radio people, and basically what I would do is, my flying was all VFR, visual flight rule. And even though you're supposed to remain in contact, I learned pretty quickly, once you leave the tower, I turn the buddy aircraft radio off. Go straight on to ham radio. I had hams all around the world. Harry Caldicott, remember that name?
2DA.
Yeah. 2DA. He would be monitoring me, 14146. Is that still 20 metres?
Yeah.
Right. I had communication with him right around the world. And so I basically used amateur radio as my total safety net. And they were always there for me. So I'm talking to Lowe's, and they said, oh, you've got to call in. And they gave me their, remember, no GPS or anything like that, but they said, you track down the UK. First of all, I'd landed and been welcomed by Prince Charles, which was great. Then I took off, had to get down and land on the Thames. And as I'm tracking down England, I'm radioing him, and I said, oh, I can see a field, I can see some kids on the field. They said, that's not kids, that's us. And that put the whole of the map, the Lowe's Low Company, which was the Yazoo agent for the UK, out onto this oval. And I landed and jumped out and said hello to them and everything, and then flew on. That's what you can do with a helicopter. And I got down to London. Then I flew from London to Sydney. Then I must tell you about the helicopter thing, about the ship's landing. I get to England, I get to Australia, two-thirds of the way around the world, and I then started writing to the Russians and saying I need to land there. And I even took the Russian ambassador out for dinner. And finally, they came back and said, no, we can't get you approval. So my second thing was to try, I sent out a sheet of paper to 200 shipping companies, and it said, I'm an Aussie flying around the world by helicopter, I'm two-thirds of the way around. I now have to fly from Japan to Alaska. I don't have enough range. I need to get a ship that's travelling across the Pacific between Japan and America that I can put a couple of drums of fuel on and land on the ship to refuel. Now, of the 200 circulars, 198 of them threw them in the bin. One wrote back saying, is this for real? I don't know if it's an April Fool's joke. And you wouldn't believe it. How's this for luck? The Hogue Company from Norway wrote back and said, we love your spirit of adventure. On the 25th of June, we have the Hogue Marlin, which is a container ship. It's going from Yokohama to Seattle. You're welcome to put some drums of fuel on the ship, but we'll take no responsibility for you. Now, how in the hell do I find the ship? So, I still own Dick Smith Electronics. We got Gil McPherson. Anyone know that name, Gil McPherson? There's one. Fantastic radio amateur and expert. He made up a non-directional beacon, an NDB, using a toroid, a little buck, he called it a dick mitt. 12-volt toroid, about 600 kilohertz. I then rang up Don, I'll think of his name in a second, who's a radio amateur, who I'd got to go with David Lewis to Antarctica. And Don Richards, I said, Don, I need you to fly to Yokohama. I'll give you my beacon to go on this ship, which is going to go from Yokohama to Seattle, and I want you, when it's about 6 days out from Yokohama, to dangle the wire over the crane, turn on the beacon, and to help me refuel. And Don said, no problems, Dick, I'll be there. And so I want you to imagine you're with me. I'm right on the northern tip of Japan. It's 3 a.m. in the morning. The ship, we know, is about halfway across the Pacific. The ship's captain reckoned he knew where he was going to be. I worked out this position. So I had to take off. People say, where is the ship waiting for you? It wasn't waiting. This was like a rendezvous in space. It was cruising at 18 knots. So I calculated, I think it was about 3.5 days out, it would be about halfway. Because if it was too early, I then wouldn't have enough fuel to get to America. If it was too late, I wouldn't have enough fuel to get to it. I made an extra tank to go on the top of the real tank. And so I lifted off that morning at 3 a.m. in pitch darkness at Kashiro with 240 US gallons on board. Normal jet Ranger holds 90 gallons. I was 20% over gross weight. Some people thought the helicopter wouldn't loft off. I remember I lifted the collective up, went to 100% power, sitting there on the skids, 120%, which you're allowed for 5 seconds, and it lifted off. I then taxied from one landing light, was raining, to the next landing light, and then just darkness. Now, I didn't have an instrument rating, but I did have a little attitude indicator. And I just bored off into the dark. And no, I did. Between the first two stages, I got back to Australia and I went and got myself an instrument rating. I decided that, and I got myself an instrument rating. Now, the helicopter wasn't instrument rated. Helicopters, unstable, dynamically unstable. A fixed wing plane is designed if you drop the nose, the airspeed will pick up, you get more lift and the nose will come up. It's stable. A helicopter, whichever way the stick falls is the way you die. So they don't allow instrument flying in normal choppers. The chopper I have now is a twin engine which has dual stability systems. So it's an IFR machine because of these probably $300,000 worth of dual computers that try and make it as stable as a fixed wing plane. But I'm in my little jet Ranger, one landing light, next landing light, darkness. And I'm heading off and I'm heading towards the coast. And after a while, the dawn starts to come up. So I climb and I can remember some fishing boats. And then I'm flying along underneath cloud and I've got to go 700 nautical miles to the ship. And I decided I'd have to get above the cloud because I needed to get greater efficiency from the engine. So I climbed up through the cloud. And I'm flying along north of Japan beside the Kamchatka Peninsula, which is Russia. And they had this great big restricted area. Well, I knew I couldn't go around it, but I put in the flight plan showing the line through it with the Japanese and they wouldn't accept it. So I then did this flight plan right around it. But the minute I left Japan, I turned off the bloody aircraft radio and just went on to ham radio. And we had these Japanese Yaesu blokes sitting in the Yaesu dealer's shop in Kagoshima on the northern tip of Japan. We had Harry Caldicott and the people back in Thinger. Pip was sitting at home with an FT1 and she wasn't allowed to talk because she wasn't a bloody radio ham, but she would whisper. And I knew it was my daughter Jenny's birthday, the 25th of June 1983, and so she prompted me, so I sang happy birthday to her, and we have a tape back to the Terry Hills house of me on this bloody shipboard landing. Now, I'd worked out I'm a risk manager, and because I've done 5 flights around the world, never even been delayed, never called search and rescue, never not done as planned, is because I really manage the risk really well. In this particular case, I wrote down about 20 things that could have gone wrong, from engine failure to lack of finding the ship, to the ship not being where it was, to the weather meaning I couldn't land on the ship. And all of those 20 things were in series, that one of them goes wrong, you're not there. And as I'm flying along through the Russian restricted area, I can see my theory was, if I can't get to the ship, I'll go and land in Russia. But I didn't realise these islands were volcanoes with a 30-degree angle. You couldn't land a chopper on a 30-degree angle. I had no idea what happened down in the ocean, but I thought I could land on the rim. And I'm flying along, I'm communicating back to Australia, and then I start communicating to the ship, Don Richards, who's got the ship radio turned onto the 20-metre band, and he's giving reports on the ship. I got to within about 80 miles of the ship, and he calls up and he says, Dick, bad news, the ship has run into fog. Complete, absolute fog, you won't be able to land. So once again, I called a high-flying airline and said, I'm an Aussie helicopter trying to fly around the world, I'm trying to find a ship. North Pacific, the ship's in the fog, so I'm now heading to Russia. Can you tell the authorities? So they get back to Australia and all hell breaks loose. Bloody Hickson is heading to Russia. And you wouldn't believe it. I thought, well, I'll never shoot someone down. 3 months to the day in the same place they shot that 747 Korean jet down, in the same place. I think it was so big they identified it. My little helicopter, I reckon they didn't have a clue, or I hope not. So I've got to make this decision. Can I go to the end of the Kamchatka Peninsula, which I could see was out of the cloud, certain I'm going to live, but the most likely thing is they'll confiscate my chopper, flying there illegally, or do I go for the ship? And the ship calls back, Don Rich, and says, we're in a bit of clear air and you want to risk it. Well, I took about 1 second to make the decision. And I remember I was at 2,500 feet above the cloud and I descended down through the cloud, hoping, I had a radar altimeter as well as a normal altimeter, and hoping that the radar altimeter would kick in, and it did at about 1,500 feet. I came out of the cloud, and ahead of me was a group of orca whales. I always remember that, beautiful, magnificent whales. I looked at it as a good luck charm. 60 miles away, I saw the ship, this little dot, and I kept flying towards it. Now, I'd never landed on a ship in my life before. And at 8 miles, they detected me on the radar, and at the beacon, by then, Don is turning the beacon on and I'm getting this reading that she's showing me to him. Every aircraft has an automatic direction finder, which works between about 300 kilohertz and 2 megs or something. And we had this 600 or 800 kilohertz transmitter, about 50 watts. So I direction found in on the ship. Had no real idea of the distance. That was just dead reckoning. And I'd gone 700 miles, been in the air 7 hours. So I come around and I land on the ship. They're all okay. We roll up the drums and we start refueling, but I'd made one error. I'd allowed 7 hours plus 1 hour plus 7 hours, 15 hours, to get into Shemya on the end of the Aleutian chain just before last light. And here I was going to go across 5 time zones and land the day before I started. But the ship's rolling like this and the jet range are refueling and the auxiliary tanks are on the side. Every time the bloody ship rolled this way, the fuel would come out of the filler. So we'd have to put the cap back on. And the ship had this great big slow roll. So we'd let it roll back this way, then pull the cap off and pump in. So it meant it took 2 hours to put the fuel on board instead of 1 hour. So do I take off? Yes, of course I did. And as I took off, I nearly hit, Don Richards was on the ship and he told me later, there's a spigot coming out, a container loading spigot, and he said, you missed the container spigot by inches. It just would have rolled the helicopter. So I came around and then I headed towards Shemya. And by then I was very tired. I hadn't slept the night before, so I'd been up for 36 hours. Little jet range and, you know, just sitting there manually on the controls. And I looked down through my feet. And I want you to understand, this is equivalent to going from Auckland, from Sydney, to 200 miles the other side of Auckland with a ship somewhere across the Tasman. If someone had told me that, I would have never done it, but because it was way up north, it didn't seem as bad. Anyway, I'm heading off, and then I misread the waves on the water and decided I had a headwind, and if I have a headwind, I couldn't get to Alaska. Everything was so fine. So I call up to the amateur radio fraternity. I said, look, I've got a headwind. Don't think I'm going to be able to get to Alaska. I'm going to try and find a ship. And in the end, I found a ship. But it's a bloody ship rolling around. It's got great big cranes on it. So I couldn't land on it. So I keep on going and going. And in the end, Pip could hear how distraught I was. So she just started talking on the amateur radio. I mean, what could they do? And that was a fantastic thing. I didn't realise there were thousands of amateurs listening. They'd been listening the whole day. People were obviously chinning the band. But what is this? Because the whole communication was going on and people were getting weather. They were ringing Anchorage and Anchorage was getting in touch with Shemya. Shemya is at the end of the Aleutian chain. It's a secret Air Force base that has the Kodrogan radar station for monitoring the Russian intercontinental ballistic missile tests. And I'd somehow got approval to land there because that was the only way I could do the flight. Anyway, after about 4 hours of flying, I realised that it wasn't a headwind, it was a tailwind. I completely misread the waves. So when I realised the tailwind, then I finally get to Attu Island and I thought, well, I'll land there, but it's got ice fields coming straight down into the ocean. There's no way you could land. So I came in around there and eventually I got to Shemya just before last light and I came in and I landed on this huge airfield designed for C-5s. And they had a chain with a lump of wood, which was the Shemya windsock. They'd been waiting for me, so I got out. And Pip has this tape because I said, I'm landing, I'm on the ground. Thanks everyone, I'm turning off. So I turned off. Well, the 14146 megahertz just came alive. We've got this tape of people from all around the world that have been listening. Probably about 30 amateurs came on. God, he's alive. Unbelievable sort of story. And the base commander took me in. I went to bed the next morning. I got up and they said, have you ever read the book called The Thousand Mile War? And I said, no. And they said, look, we'll give you a copy on the understanding you don't read it until you get to Anchorage. Okay, so I took this book. The book is The Thousand Mile War, which is the thousand miles of the Aleutian chain in the Second World War. And I wish I had read it because I nearly killed myself. It talked about the very bad weather and they have these terrible low fogs, and it was, they lost more aircraft because of weather than anything else. But as I flew up the Aleutian chain, am I going too long or is it? No. I'm heading up the Aleutian chain and I see this island called Kiska. Oh, I think I want to have a pee anyway, so I thought I'll land in Kiska. So that's the beautiful thing about a chopper. I would land, I mean, illegally everywhere all around the world. And as I'm flying over Kiska, I see a gun emplacement. Oh, that's interesting. It looked like an old gun. So I came in, swapped in with a helicopter, landed beside the gun, get out, turned off, had a piddle, and then wandered up to the gun and had Japanese writing on it. So then I decided to go for a walk along the peninsula. I walked right along. There's old buildings and there's old military stuff, and down in the bay there's a wrecked submarine. I thought, God, this is a really incredible place. I'll have to come back here. So eventually I go back and I get back in a helicopter. I'm not talking to air traffic control anyone. I've turned off from Chevron, talking to AM radio. And to Don in the ship, the ship's cruising towards Seattle. So I'm talking to him each day as he's getting sort of parallel to me. So then I fly all day and I get to ADAC, which is Naval Air Station ADAC. And I land there and I refuel and then I walk into the military briefing office. It's a naval station. And there is this bloody great map of the Aleutian chain, and then it's got Kiska, this island, and it's got a huge, great, big, red, restricted area around it. And I said, oh, what's the restricted area at Kiska? And the bloke looked at me and said, oh, you wouldn't want to go there. And I said, oh, why? And he said, that's the only bit of America that was held by Japan in the Second World War, and it's covered in landmines. And I'd just been wandering around. You'd be lucky, that's it. And I said, oh, fair enough, I didn't say anything. My book appears with the photographs of Kiska and the gun emplacement and everything. So anyway, so I flew up and to Alaska and then right down. And just as I'm getting to Fort Worth, two exciting things happened. I'm flying along and I see below me the road sign for Texas. So I think I'll land there beside the sign on the road and take a photograph of my chopper parked in front of Texas. After being nearly 12 months coming right around the world, 50,000 kilometres, 350 hours, still alive. And as I'm taking the photograph, an American pickup truck arrives and it's got these two ranch hands. And they look at me and it's got Solar around the world, you know, Qantas on the little helicopter. And they said, where did you start? And I said, oh, I started in Fort Worth. And I'm only about 60 miles from Fort Worth, 100 miles. One looks at the other and says, you've got a long way to go. He didn't realise. They said, no, I've come around the other way. I said, I'm nearly back. And then if you look at my documentary, as I'm flying in to Fort Worth, so it must have been about 11 o'clock in the morning, so that's 10 hours. It must have been about midnight or 1 a.m. in Sydney. I talked to Harry Caldicott on 14146, a 5x9 signal. Unbelievable. Saying, Harry, I'm just about to land. Thanks for the amateur radio coverage right around the world. And the radio I use, by the way, is a synthesized Collins HF transceiver. You just dial up any frequency, standard aircraft transceiver, little 9-foot long wire antenna and a automatic tuning unit, which go click, 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 LEDX switches. And you dial up the channel, it would go click, 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 and tune. And so that was the most inspirational flight for me because it was before GPS and before Iridium phones. The last, I've done 5 flights around the world. I did, the second flight was a vertical flight from Sydney to Antarctica, South Pole, up to the North Pole, landing at both poles. That's the only flight that I've done that's never been repeated and will be a hard one to repeat, especially if the North Pole ice melts, because that's just floating sea. Then I did a helicopter flight from our front lawn at Terry Hills. I wanted to go around the world the other way, so I conned Pimping to, I said, look, it's only fair you come around the world, seeing you have to mind the kids when I went that way. So we bought a Sikorsky helicopter, which is a great big twin engine thing, previously owned by the King of Jordan. And we took off from Terry Hills, and 12 months later we were back at Terry Hills having flown the other way around the world, all at about 300 feet. And just amazing. We had a big opening window on the back, and she took photographs, and we just cruised up into around Everest and around Europe and across the Pacific. By then, Russia had opened up, so right through Russia, no shipboard landings, and back home. Then the last two flights I've done are in my Cessna Caravan, which is a single-engine Cessna. Both of them with GPS, and both with Iridium phones. And I remember I've got a little movie of me when I'm landing at Timbuktu. As a kid, my parents used to say they're going to send me to Timbuktu. So I did a flight from Bankstown to Timbuktu, kept on going, and as I'm landing at Timbuktu on the Iridium phone, you can hear me talking back to Pip as if you're on just a normal standard telephone, because nowadays the communication is so fantastic. I have in all of my aircraft a little spider tracks unit, which is an Iridium tied up with the GPS, and every minute it transmits my position. And if you grab my phone, we'll see if it'll work, I'll hand it around, it will show exactly where the which of my aircraft, where they flew last. So we're just going to go, it says fetching aircraft, doing dashboard tracks. How does it work? Probably won't work now. And it's amazing. Oh, here you are. So we've got Augusta Caravan Long Range Summit. Look at the Augusta. And there's the flight. You can pass that around if you want to. That would be probably every 2 minutes. And that's, imagine this, it's 30 cents a message from a little thing the size of a cigarette pack that's transmitting the aircraft position anywhere in the world back, and it appears on your phone. So my wife can follow where I am if I've gone somewhere, sort of thing. So basically, in closing, what I've seen in aviation and in my life is to go from the valves of that we all know, and a computer being a big deal with 4K, we had that original System 80 computer, and in my early days in radio and communications, one person could basically understand it all. I had an understanding when I was 17 or 18. You could ask me anything about the field of radio and electronics, and I could explain how it worked, because I knew that. That's not so anymore. I've met an engineer from Apple, and I said, can you explain everything in that phone? And he said, no. He said, nobody can. He said, it's so specialised. The person who understands how the hell the GPS works in it would have no understanding of how the camera works. He said, it's just beyond comprehension now. And remember, the first transistor I bought was an AC71. I think it was in about May 1956. It was £3.17, which is $100 in today's money. And that, I think it has 2 million transistors on it. Probably all more, isn't it? It's 2 billion transistors in it, or gates, memory things and so forth. So this incredible change, and it's interesting, I'm wondering if people will start flying around the world now without a GPS to get the challenge back. A friend of mine who followed me solo around the world, he had 5 GPSs in. And I said, why did you have 5 GPSs? And he said, I couldn't fit 6 in. And they're so cheap, and you don't want to be lost. But it's sort of taken away. I mean, Kings of Smith days, they mainly flew at night because they had a sextant to get shots on the stars. I didn't ever have, I'm not a skilled astro-navigator, but I had to use dead reckoning and be incredibly frightened. I was scared when I flew across an ocean. But it's a drug. It's interesting. I fly up the coast sometimes in my helicopter, and I'm tempted to turn right just to head across the ocean to see if I can get away with it. And it really is a drug to fly long distances over oceans when you're navigating, when you're scared, and when you finish, you think, wow, that was amazing. And people often ask me, what do I owe the fact that I've been able to complete these flights? And there's two things: luck, tremendous amount of luck, and North American technology. You know, to me, my life has been dependent on the most incredibly reliable technology that's come out of that North American free enterprise system. that little jet ranger, it has an Allison gas turbine, which is like a plumber's blow lamp with a windmill in the gases. But it has a Woodward governor in it, which is those spinning weights. It is so tiny, you'd think it came from a Carnot set. Now, if that little Woodward governor fails, the weights fail, the engine goes back to flight idle and I'm auto-rotating into the ocean. But it never failed. I've done 7,000 hours in helicopters and haven't had one fail yet. So it is amazing that this simple little mechanical thing can be so reliable. And that's what I owe my life to North American technology just being so reliable. There are places where I've been, I know if I'd had an engine failure, I wouldn't live. Recently, last year at this time, I did 30 years after my flight around the world, I did a circumnavigation of Papua New Guinea. And luckily, I've got spider tracks. Do you reckon I'll see my watch in my phone again?
It's already on a bike.
I've got spider tracks. You're flying over jungle in PNG, that is just so thick. I reckon if you came down in it, I don't know how anyone would find you. And that's, to me, worse than the ocean, because you have a life jacket and a beacon. In very many cases these days, turn on the beacon, they have you within 20 minutes by satellite, and they'll be sending someone out to drop a life raft, let's hope. But being in that jungle would be very difficult. Just in closing, funny little story. I'm flying around the northern coast of Papua New Guinea, and I decided I wanted to get some food out of the back of the helicopter. I was in a Bell, I've got a Bell Long Ranger, just a single engine chopper, and I looked around, and most of Papua New Guinea has people, but I found an area of about 100 miles of coast where there wasn't one village, one road, one clearing, nothing. Absolutely just virgin jungle. So I came in and I landed on a gravel bank on the river. And you wouldn't believe it, I landed within 2 minutes of landing, 20 natives came out of the jungle with great big machetes, but great big grins on their faces.
Lunch.
And they had their grins on their faces, and so I shut down. They were so friendly. They spoke a bit of pidgin, which I don't speak. So in the end, I thought I'd better give them a gift. So I looked in the back of the helicopter, and as you would all have, I had a can of Dick Smith beetroot with my face on the can. So I gave it to them, and he couldn't understand what it was. And I said, like potato, but purple, this colour. And then he looked at the photo and he looked at me, oh, you know. So off he went with the can of beetroot, and I'm sure there's a new cargo cult there. A big bird from the sky. And I don't know what's happened to the beetroot. So that was a little story there. Anyway, thanks for listening to me. And it was an interesting little story because I got to Stornoway, which is an island, the town is called Stornoway, just off the coast of Scotland, and I luckily got out my map for the next day, and Balmoral Castle just had a great big restricted area around it. So went into the service station, bought a road map which showed Balmoral. Now, good helicopter pilots like me, we never get lost, but sometimes we get temporally displaced. And so I flew across and I found a Loch Ness. And I'm flying along, and I can't work out, but I get to a road junction. So I've got the road map sitting on my knee, and I think, I can't read the road sign. So it's quite early in the morning, so I drop down in the chopper, and I'm hovering at about a metre above the road, reading the road sign on my map. What I haven't realised is a police car's come up over the rise, and stopped. And there's two... what looked like London bobbies, but they're obviously Scottish policemen in their full uniform, with their mouths open. And the minute I saw them, they're only about 10 metres away, I quickly pulled the collective on, and up over the police station. And I'm sure they would have gone back to the police station saying, Sarge, you're not going to believe me. There's a helicopter solo around the world, and there's a bloke reading a road map. And actually, that's how I found Balmoral Castle, was to follow the roads, because, see, you don't have GPS. It's very hard to navigate. And so I'm really glad that I did those first flights before it became so easy. Now it's a complete moving map with the roads and everything on it, sort of thing. So I came in and landed with Prince Charles, and Pip had flown with the two girls to Scotland, and saw them for the first time in a month. I'd never been away from them very much at all. And then, as I mentioned, flew down to London that afternoon. So that was successful.
You must find it really... you've done the helicopters, then you also cross Australia in a balloon, where you can't just land and read the road signs. Do you find that frustrating?
Well, no, the ballooning is the riskiest thing I've ever done, and I don't really like balloon flying. See, balloon flying is safe if you do it early in the morning and late in the afternoon with no wind, and you'll notice any good balloon pilot, the minute they see the wind coming up, they land the damn thing. Now, here we are. There'd been about 7 attempts across Australia, and all had failed. And I thought, I wouldn't mind having a go at that. So I went, they were going to have a balloon race across the Atlantic. So I went to Bangor in Maine and did the briefings of these five balloons. One of them ended up in the ocean, one went this way. I think two got across the Atlantic. Learned as much as I could. And then I chose a very good balloon pilot in Australia, John Wallington. I went and got my balloon license. But he had never been in a balloon more than about an hour and never been above about 8,000 feet sort of thing, because they just fly them in the daytime. And then we took off from Carnarvon, and we were at 23,000 feet sitting at 80 knots, 160 kilometres an hour. And I didn't like being in the gondola, and I had no fear of heights, so I made a little sun veranda. And I had a deck chair, and I'm sitting up on the sun veranda at 23,000 feet with a... down 23,000. I've got a great shot of the camera. I go, oh, look down there. So, and my jet flew around me to do some television links, and Pip keeps calling, put on your safety harness. And I said, I'm not going to let go. So I didn't bother to put the safety harness on. So we're cruising across Australia, and we know we're going to get near the coast at darkness. We have to cross the Great Divide. So what do? Then we'll be out in the ocean the next day. We want to land near the coast. And so eventually said, we've got to come down. So we've never... It's a combination hot air and helium balloon. That's how you get the great range. And so we start letting some gas out, and the balloon starts descending. We get to Tenterfield, and we think it's sensible to land at Tenterfield. We'll be alive. We won't go across the Great Divide. But then we thought of that for a minute. We thought, no, let's take the risk. And so off across the Great Divide. And we then started descending, but we completely lost control of the balloon. At one stage, John says, quick, throw out a bag of sand. So I throw out a bag of sand, and we actually overtook the sand we were going down. We were going to get killed. And so in the end, I cut the beautiful Honda generator loose and threw my deck chair and everything out, all since recovered by farmers who bought them to us. And finally, we arrested the descent of the balloon. And it's coming down towards the Clarence Valley over the Great Divide. And suddenly I said to John, you're not going to believe this. There is no wind down there. And can you imagine after 70 hours in the air or whatever it was, two nights, here we are, we land in zero wind conditions. Just the most amazing fluke. Then the flight across the Tasman was interesting, because I was going to fly from Australia to New Zealand, because you fly balloons in the westerly wind. And John Singleton, my mate, said, oh, hey, fly the other way. And I said, you can't fly the other way, you mug. I said, a balloon flies in the bloody wind and they're westerlies. And he said, oh, I bet you 100 grand you can't fly the other way. And at first of all, I thought, well, that's ridiculous, you can't. But then I spoke to the Met Bureau and I said, would it be possible? And they said, well, let's have a look. And they put into the computer, and they came back and they said, there's about twice a year, if you have a high-pressure system that sits over the Tasman, anti-clockwise, the wind around a high-pressure system. Yeah, that's right, yeah. They said, can you stay very low? And I said, yeah, we can just skim the waves. And they said, well, you might be able to do it. The problem will be if the high-pressure system moves, as it does, you'll parallel the coast and then end up in Antarctica. So what we did, I rang up Singer and I said, your bet's on. We sent the balloon over there, and we chartered a fishing boat from Ballina to come out. Because I thought, if we'll drop in the ocean, and I'd be criticised if I got someone to rescue me, of course. And we took off from New Zealand when they said the weather system was right. We had this incredible flight across. As we started to get towards the coast, we started to parallel it. But we got the Weather Bureau to put up a Met balloon, and at 8,000 feet, there was an easterly wind. Most amazing. So we climbed the balloon up to 8,000 feet, came in on the easterly wind. And then the most amazing thing, most balloons across an ocean never land on the beach. And we actually landed the gondola, well, John Wellington did, on the wave, and we surfed it in on the wave. And so that was the crossing. Now, balloons, I don't want to do any more balloon flying. It's frightening. You've got 3.5 tons doing 80 knots. You know that if you're going to come in at more than about 20 knots, you could be killed. The worst thing is dragging into a power line. You can't go anywhere low at night because you'll hit a power line and they'll short, and you see what happens when a balloon hits power lines. They were two just great adventures, you know, to do these things which hadn't been done before. And as I said, I've been lucky that I do my homework well. I bought a proven balloon. I was criticised by Phil Kavanagh, who designed an Australian balloon. But I said, I'm not going to do something that's unproven, even though I like Australia. Yes, at the back.
Did Singo come up with 100 G's?
Yeah, he came up with 100 G's. Yeah. We don't owe it to charity, so it just went to the course.
Richard Branson.
Any other questions? No. Oh, I've exhausted you all. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming out. Listen, we're here every Wednesday night, so you're always
here. So anyone do CW? Do you still do
it? Oh, yeah. Who does CW here? I don't. I'm with Dick here. It's too hard.
Is there a net? Is anyone on 20 metres these days?
Oh, there's as much CW as there is SSB, Dick.
But what about SSB? What frequency is there a Sunday? Does the WIA still have a Sunday?
Oh, they still have a broadcast. Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah, it's all still going.
7045.
You want to turn the radio on one day?
I will. They still have Duralas.
Yes. Yeah.
It's all moved out there now. Though.
Yeah.
What? It's all moved out there.
They haven't got Atchison Street or Parramatta. They moved Atchison Street to Parramatta, but now it's all at Dural.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's good.
Oh, that's good. And no really young amateurs. Oh, there's one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's good. So that's good. Have you got a license or going to get one?
Yeah, I got my alcohol. A couple of months ago.
Oh, good on you. What's that?
It had three extra letters.
Yeah. And can you, so what can you do with that? What frequency can you get? 2 meters?
All of them.
Not really all, but segments of.
Yeah.
It's a good foundation license.
Are they planning to take the bands off amateurs, or don't people use HF that much?
They'll have to.
Yeah,
kind of a convincing story to take it off us, but
yeah.
there's still a lot of activity on HF radio.
The higher frequencies they taken away,
because the higher frequencies are more valuable than HF.
Yeah. I wonder if there'll be a time when HF doesn't really get used other than by amateurs.
Probably will.
Yeah, the shortwave broadcasters are slowly.
So in other words, does we still have Radio Australia on shortwave?
Yes.
But all the big ones like Voice of America and the BBC and that are scaling back their broadcasts. I still listen occasionally on those commercial frequencies, but it's not like it was 10 years ago.
Now, where's my phone?
You can pick it up next week.
I know we have a lady here. Back in my day, 1962, there was Muriel. You look up the old amateur radio book, we had one radio ham. Gee, there's something from the old days. Wow.
So did your phone,
we still have it. Yeah. I think Gil McPherson designed this.
Probably paid for some of the fuel. Yeah.
Wow. It's a DSE commander. Look at that.
Is it still under warrant?
Does it work?
It wasn't the exploder.
So was it a kit? Was it a kit? Looks too professional. Ike Bain, who worked for me, came up with this expression, our kids look so good your friends won't believe you.
You're building.
It's a really good statement.
What's he doing now?
Ike is retired. And my best friend, believe it or not, is Gary Johnson, who owns Jaycar.
Yeah.
And he, people say he disappointed with Dick Smith. So I said, well, Dick Smith moved to consumer electronics.
Yeah.
And Gary Johnson He worked with me at Dick Smith's. There's an incredible story. I sold Dick Smith's to Woolworths. Gary had always talked about going out on his own. And I always looked in the Sydney Morning Herald for businesses for sale. And I see this ad for John Carr and Company. So I cut out the ad and take it to him, attach it to an email, said, Gary. And he rings up John Carr and Company, buys them, and that's J Carr. And as you know, J Carr has taken over what Dick Smith used to do. And they do it really well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can have it if you want.
I have it. Oh, yeah, sure. I would love it because I've got
it's yours.
Yeah, that is a fantastic gift. Thank you very much. I do have, I've got a System 80 and a Sorcerer computer. Just a few things have been given to me. I'll also remember the radar detector called Wakefoot, the Dick Tracer. Then we had the Dick power supply and the Big Dick.
Yes.
What happened there was, I'll put this in my book when I write it. We first started to import, and the company in Japan said, oh, you've now, Shomei Trading, you've now got, your orders are so big, you can have your own brand. And we didn't have a brand. I said, I'll just put any brand on it. So the power supplies arrived, and they're called Dick Power Supplies. We were horrified. Dick Power Supplies, you know, just pathetic. But everyone loved the Dick Power Supplies. So then when we got the bigger version, we called it the Big Dick. And that was even more popular. And it's interesting. I've been in arbitration, in mediation today, because someone's trying to pinch our Aussie Mike name. And so we're thinking of maybe calling it, one idea was Dickie Might. That's a bit tame. I'm thinking of calling it Mighty Dick. We recommend it to Mighty Dick. So we haven't decided yet.
Mighty Might.
Yeah. No, there is Mighty Might. That's yeah. That's free foods. That's
so, oh, yeah.
You're going to keep going with the foods?
Yeah, I'd like to. I mean, it's very hard because all of us say we support Australian foods, but most of us just buy the cheapest. People are not feeling that patriotic when they go to the supermarket. So it's interesting. As you notice, I've announced about five times we're closing down. I've had more closing downs than Dave Millie Nell. But what happens is if I announce we're closing it down, we then get gate coverage. Everyone runs in and buys our food. So then we don't close it down. And this year, I mean, we will, as you know, we give all the money to charity. We'll give $1 million away this year. So it means over 7 million so far, and I'll keep running it when we can give good money to charity. The problem we've got is that hardly any suppliers are left that are Aussie owned anymore.
Yeah.
See, anyone who's any good is immediately sold out, and one after the other, our people who made our beautiful beetroot have gone broke, Windsor Farms, and then the Carra Cannery went broke, just everyone just goes broke. So it's really sad. And so it's a battling proposition whether you can ever keep it going. And I think that's really
sad. We've signed another free trade agreement so we can go broke even quicker.
Yeah. I mean, that's an amazing thing. I suppose, I mean, I can understand you rebuy electronics from China because they make the best and cheapest electronics, but surely we should be growing food for the world. But if most of the food in our supermarkets, other than the fresh food, all the other stuff's, most of it's either imported or from a foreign-owned company. It's quite amazing. Any chance of a coffee?
There's a chance.
Anyway, thanks for that.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate it.